Stanford University.
So this panel, we're going to ask our alumni to talk a little bit about their time at Stanford and how it shaped their careers, and maybe a little bit about where they're going, sort of their impact, the impact of the CS department on them, and then their impact on the world. And I just want to start with a really short personal note, because CS department had a huge impact on me as a young man. I wandered into Trester Union in 1971, the fall of 1971, as a college sophomore, not here. The Trester Union was in its folky phase. It was more of a Joan Baez, Bob Dylan kind of place. And against the wall, there was this luminous display. And beneath it were these joysticks. And I knew television at that point as being one way. And all of a sudden, I realized that, hey, this is wild. Television is two-way. Television is interactive. And it is something that had been built by a Stanford computer science student. Many of the people might know it as Space War, but at Stanford it was called Galaxy Game, and it was actually the first coin-operated video game in history. It was called Galaxy Game because it was built during the height of the anti-war movement, and calling it Space War on campus was considered a branding mistake. Seeing that had this huge influence on me, and it shaped my interest as a reporter for the rest of my life, actually. So why don't we start with Vint? Could you talk about being here as a student and what it did for you?
Well, so I had the disadvantage that I left just as the computer science department was being formed. I was here from 61 to 65 and took every computer science class I could take while I was still in the math department as a student, and went to work for IBM. So I was infected very quickly with excitement about computing for the same reasons that Marissa said earlier, this idea that you could get a machine and make it do whatever you wanted to do. It was sort of like your very own personal universe. You could make it do whatever you wanted. Of course, it didn't do what you wanted. It did what you told it to do, which are not always the same thing. So I left Stanford just as computer science was happening, and I didn't return until 1972, when the computer science department had been in operation. But my experience here was very formative. Not only did I discover I wasn't a very good mathematician, but I also discovered that computing was a lot of fun. We got to use the Burroughs 5000, soon to become the 5500. We programmed in Balgol, and the machine itself was fascinating. So I got very interested in that field, went to work for IBM for 2 years, and then realized that I didn't know enough about the theory behind computing, operating system design, programming language design, and went back to school in Los Angeles at UCLA. But I have to say, maybe later in this discussion, I'd like to say something about the impact of computer science and electrical engineering during my tenure as a professor here, because it really made a huge difference to be on the Stanford campus.
Which years were you here?
72 to 76. Okay. And that's when the internet design was actually happening. And there was something about the students and the atmosphere and the supportive nature of the faculty made a dramatic difference for me. So I'd like to come back to that, but my student years were just on the hairy edge of computer science.
Bill.
Yeah, I'm Bill Coughran. I was at Stanford, I think, from 1975 to 1980. The department had been established for a while. George Forsyth had passed away. His wife was around at the time. And I had been pursuing mathematics and physics at Caltech as an undergraduate and came here as a graduate student. And it was still early days, I think, for a lot of computing ideas and so forth. And it was a lot of fun. My horizons about what computing could be and what it would become broadened a lot when I was here at Stanford. And I think, like many of the students, the faculty were wonderful, but I think at the end of the day, I learned a lot more from the other students than I did from the faculty.
Mike?
Yeah, I graduated in 97 undergrad, and then I did it backwards. I actually stopped out of the co-term program and went into industry, and right in the middle of the first dot-com boom in 99, I came back to school and finished the master's, and then started my company and the end of 2000, right after the NASDAQ crash. So I kind of got the timing. You could either call me brilliantly counter-cyclical or just doing it wrong, but depending on your point of view. But when I came to Stanford, I thought I wanted to be a theoretical physicist. And the Physics 60 program, I don't know if it's still called Physics 60, it's the third tier, convinced me very quickly that I was not going to be a theoretical physicist. So I took E40, and which was the intro electrical engineering class, and CS106A. And that sealed the deal really quickly. I think, like a lot of people here, the whole ability to sit down in front of a terminal, type, and then create something, whatever you can imagine, the limits of your time, attention, and imagination, is to this day still unbelievable to me.
Yeah. Ted, say a little bit about your timing. How countercyclical were you when you came out? What was it like?
What do you mean?
Well, in terms of what greeted you when you left? In terms of
this was 97, where things were really starting to take off, and then 99, when I was actually working part-time and completing my master's here, because I promised my parents when I stopped out that I would finish, and so I had to finish it. But that was the height of craziness in terms of Silicon Valley for everyone who was here during
Right.
Which is, you had everyone in the world packing their bags and throwing it into their Volkswagen and driving into Silicon Valley to find a job in tech because, it was the our generation's oil boom for what's happening here. And it certainly calmed down a lot, after the NASDAQ crash, and now it's coming back in a different form.
Yeah. David.
Well, let's see, what originally brought me into computer science was cognitive psychology. I actually had a double major at UCSD in math and what was called applied physics and information sciences, but it was basically sort of a hardware-oriented double E program. I had written, one or two programs as an undergraduate and would have gone on in cognitive psychology, but my advisor at UCSD said, look, if you want to do that, that's great, but if I were doing it now, I being him, I would go to Stanford or MIT and go into artificial intelligence because it's kind of happening. And at Stanford, I was interested in the AI part, definitely not systems or numerical analysis or hardware or pretty much any of the other things that we were required to learn about, and wasn't very good and had no background and so forth. My thesis had to do with computer architecture applied to things that might be relevant to AI or database management systems, but it was all still within computer science. Later, I don't want to make it like a bio, there's a connection here, which is I became a computer science professor and was doing more, not proving theorems anymore, but building machines, but it was still all computer science. And I didn't feel 100%, I didn't know it then, but I didn't really feel like a computer scientist until I left Columbia and started applying it to other things and realized I kind of had absorbed the mindset of the whole computer science area. So I applied it to finance, to biochemistry, I realized some of it was by osmosis, just sort of learning actual things and having to go back and learn numerical analysis because it was relevant to what I was doing, but a lot of it was just coming up with things like, oh, this is financeable, this is what these guys are doing, why that's just a random walk with a reflecting barrier, right? And this, let's program it. A lot of the time the arrogance turned out to not work, occasionally it did. And now I feel like I do this or I do that, but I am a computer scientist.
David, question?
Sure. So when I was here on the faculty, I think you were still here. What years were you here?
I cut down in 1980.
Oh, so that was afterwards. You were doing
this.
Yeah,
but I started in 1972. Oh. It was an embarrassingly long period of time.
You had to come out right. Well, you were doing this non-von thing, non-von Neumann computer design. And the reason I'm asking is that, first of all, I think you went away from that. But second, doesn't it feel like it's about time to go back to ask questions like, why do we have to do it the way von Neumann did? Aren't there other alternative architectures that would let us make better use of the technology?
Yeah.
That's actually
what we do in my research group now is build highly non-standard architectures for molecular dynamic simulation. So some of the skills go across, but again, it's just sort of like, this is so irritating. The experimentalists, they squirt water at things and they have x-rays, who knows what they're doing, but can't we just describe Newton's laws of motion and do it? And so again, it was just a computer science mentality.
How many of you spent time at SAIL when it was on Arrastrio Road?
I did.
Just
I only spent, actually, this is kind of embarrassing. I wasn't in AI. I was, you know, sort of this math major guy. But they had the prancing pony vending machine up there. And there was this guy that used to bring really good Chinese food from Sinan or whatever it was down at Town and Country. And so you could log in and, you know, they would figure out whether you were old enough to have beer or not. And so I would hang out mostly for the food.
David, culturally, could you describe what Sale was like? I mean, what was Sale important for your period here as a student?
Oh, it was just a wonderful location, this futuristic, idyllic thing up on the hill. But, you know, just coming in there every day and you had to dodge robots going around in the hall. And, you know, it was a remarkable thing in ways I never even realized until many years later. Very yeah. strange environment.
Yeah. So, you know, when the CS department was formed 50 years ago, it was actually an outgrowth of mathematics, and it came out of the School of Humanities, and then it moved over to engineering. So I wanted to ask you each if you think of yourselves as scientists or engineers, and if it makes a difference. What is computer science? Who has a thought?
I'll take a shot at it if nobody else will. I was a student here when I think the department. I got my master's degree, and I think it says humanities and science school on it, and then when I got my PhD 2 or 3 years later, it said engineering. I remember the department agonized over that change at the time. I guess my impression now, many years later, is that it is more of an engineering discipline. A lot of what computer science does is applications, integrating things. I think a lot of, you know, fundamental data structures and algorithms have been explored. I think there's still opportunities for kind of new things, but it feels like a somewhat constrained universe. It doesn't feel like it's like fundamental physics research, for example. And so to me, it felt more natural over time to become part of the School of Engineering, although I do remember it was very agonizing at the point of transition.
I distinctly remember all of my EE friends telling me over and over again I wasn't a real engineer, because real engineers have accreditation, and I didn't have that. And so I spent a long time saying I was a computer scientist, not an engineer, as an overhang from 2 decades ago. But I'll say the one thing that I think is just pushing on what Bill said is even more fundamental about computer science is that I think the concepts of computer science apply to lots of other domains outside of computing, particularly on, you know, decomposing large problems into smaller parts and building interfaces. And I think the number of times certainly I and others have had to apply these to, for example, how to organize large groups of people to do something productive. And trying to use similar problem-solving decomposition techniques, kind of building robust interfaces between disparate systems to eliminate failures. Like, the more we as humans could apply these techniques to other problem domains, I think the better off it would be. So I think it's a fundamental way of thinking in many ways, and I'm excited about that.
Yeah. David, you're sort of closest to the boundary in terms of what you're doing now.
Yeah,
do you think of yourself as a scientist or an engineer?
You know, what I think of myself is as a computer scientist, as distinct from those. It always seemed to me like computer science was probably closest to engineering. The argument could be math in some point, both theory and algorithms. Part of that was math too. And the hardest case to make was science. You could apply it to science, but as a science, not in the typical Karl Popper sort of a sense. Anyway.
So I've always felt like I've labeled myself a computer scientist because that's what my degree says. It says computer science. But the longer I've been in this game, the more I realize that what I really care about is stuff that works. And there's an element of engineering hiding in there. Mm-hmm. So two observations. The first one is that artificial intelligence suffers from the following problem. Once it works, it's not artificial intelligence anymore. And as long as it doesn't work, it's still AI. The other observation, the opposite side of this divide and conquer notion, is making sure that after you divided and conquered, that it all goes together in some way that actually makes sense. So there is this architectural theme, which for me is really important. I mean, I like the idea of breaking things down, but I only feel comfortable doing that if I actually know how I'm going to put all the pieces back together again. And so for me, architecture is really important. In some places, that's somehow a dirty word because an architect doesn't actually get his hands dirty. I feel like I've got my hands plenty dirty in the course of my career, but I think that the architectural side is as important as the breaking things down to get them done in parallel.
Mike, you sort of brought this up. You know, when I'm trained as a social scientist, and in the 1970s when I was being trained, we used to pride ourselves in this notion of critical thinking. And then I met Jeanette Wing when she was in NSF, and she had this notion of computational thinking, which I got very invested in. I thought this was a great idea, until I bumped into Leslie Lamport, who is Microsoft's Turing winner, and I sort of posed the notion of computational thinking to me, and he said, no, he really didn't like that. He preferred something that he thought of as mathematical thinking. So what are we talking about here? I mean, is this simply, is it advertising for the field, or is there something deeper?
God, does anybody want to channel Leslie here? But if I were, I listened to a lecture that Leslie gave at the Heidelberg Laureate Forum last year. It was a magnificent lecture on ways of getting programs to describe what it was you wanted the program to do. And Leslie's point, I think, was exactly that this is not computational. This is more a question of trying to get at the core of what this piece of software is trying to do and expressing that in a way that was manipulable by machine. So I think I understand why he would make a distinction between mathematical and computational. The mathematical part gives you this elegant, potentially elegant language for describing what something is supposed to do. Though, by the way, if any of you are still reading things like CACM, the April issue of CACM is a really interesting article by some guys at Amazon who are using a descriptive language called TLA, which I'm sure stands for three-letter acronym. couldn't possibly be anything else. But they're using it to describe fairly complex and very distributed programs in an attempt to say something about their performance. It's not quite proof of anything, but it's more like being able to make assertions about the software. Frankly, I'm getting excited about that because what you heard earlier today, their beginning, and something I think even Marissa brought this up, which is that security is mostly a consequence, lack of security is a consequence of bugs. Bugs are a consequence of our inability to write software that doesn't have bugs. And the consequence of that is that we need to learn how to write software better than we have in the last 50 or 70 years.
Well, to that point, Dan Bona, I think, sort of jokingly talked about job security. but, there's really no responsibility. Should the field have more of a responsibility when things go wrong? I mean, you've got job security. What about the other side of the coin? Have you guys gotten off scot-free for giving us Windows and, whatever the...
We programmers have gotten away with murder, right?
Literally, in some cases. I mean, how could you redress that?
Well, someday it will get forced on us. I mean, liability is still not quite there, but the more we are surrounded by software, especially as this Internet of Things cooks along, the higher the probability that things will go wrong in ways that people will not tolerate, in which case I think there will be some serious forcing functions. Members of Congress, as you know, think that the way you solve problems is to pass a law. When they're not doing that, they're passing gas. That's a whole other problem. But the point is that if we don't do something to remedy the problem by learning how to build software that's more reliable and safe, then somebody else is going to pass laws saying you're not supposed to do that. And when we fail, there will be liabilities and consequences. Not a good outcome.
The others of you, is it possible? I mean, can we make more reliable systems? Or is it?
I think there are some optimistic or some positive proof case studies. If you think about the number of lines of code that's running in the airliner that you fly to get over here, and how rarely we have an issue that's related to software in terms of airline safety. Like, I can't remember one in recent memory. They may be confusing interfaces for the pilots, or human error, or mechanical repair maintenance issues are the most common. It's usually pilot error, then mechanical issues in that order, but not software. And that's, I think, an incredible case where it was clear to everyone writing that software that this was the important feature which was keep the airplane in the air and land it safely, and everything else was an add-on. And so I think that may be the extreme version of it. Now, I think that happens through a lot of other trade-offs, which is it's much slower to write that software, takes a lot more resources than it would otherwise to program, you know, the next app for the App Store. But so I think to me it's a question of getting the efficiencies there, where you could do that sort of quality work without all of the time and resource trade-off that it currently entails.
You know, at Google, we have all these massage chairs, and they're programmed, and I never sit in them because I'm afraid one of them is going to go like that.
I
mean.
I think that, you know, there is more work being done, again, with formal verification, and I think language design to try to make it possible to have more, at least identify more bugs and so forth. I do see some things, but I completely agree with Mike. I think, for example, as automated cars and car systems come into play, there's going to be much less tolerance for a car crushing a human when it's automatically piloted versus when a human is driving a car. So I think Vint is right. I think it's going to catch up with us one of these days.
I just have to say from my own point, you know, I covered computer security as a reporter for 30 years, and after Anonymous and Les Sec, I decided if I had to write about one more testosterone-poisoned teenage boy with an attitude, I was going to have an aneurysm, and I quit because I needed to do something else. So I really hope you do make progress. CS is such a fast-moving field. Jerry Kaplan is a friend of mine who was a postdoc here, said that he thought that PhDs should have shelf life expiration dates.
Glad I didn't stay for that PhD.
What would you, if you're talking to the new graduate students, what would you tell them to try to extend their shelf life in terms of how they approach, or even CS students, to extend their lifetime of being relevant in terms of what they should, how they should approach the field?
Well, you know, the obvious thing is two things. First of all, it's very clear that the idea that you go to school, learn a trade, and work for X number of years and retire is not a good model for our field at all. Second observation is that if you don't keep learning, the half-life of what you know will dissipate very quickly, mm-hmm. which says you got to keep going to school in some sense. And that's why I keep getting excited about the possibility of MOOCs helping, because they give you access to things at your, you know, pace and leisure, so to speak. I'm hoping that we'll be able to fashion this kind of training in a way that's easily accessible and keeps our workforce up to date. In some sense, having access to things like the internet would help that, because it delivers these things in a fairly easy way as long as you have adequate bandwidth. So I'm hoping that the seeds of solution to the problem lie in the problem itself, which is that the technology is racing along very quickly and we have to find a way to keep up.
Yeah. Other thoughts?
Yeah, always be learning. Yeah. I'm going to use a three-letter acronym, ABA. Always be learning.
Always be learning.
Yeah. Got to keep up.
Well, you know, a lot of people stay in their jobs because they are learning. If you stop learning, a lot of people get bored. And so the way to keep, you know, excited about what you're doing is to keep learning things, new things, and being confronted with new things. At Google, it's wonderful, right, because everybody is younger than I am. And so I think people, you know, kids, from my point of view, come running up and say, why don't we do X for some value of X? And I'll think, geez, we tried that 25 years ago and it didn't work. And then I have to remember, well, there's a reason why it didn't work, and that may no longer be a valid reason because things are cheaper, there's more memory, the speeds are faster. And so I've had to rethink a whole lot of dumbass positions that I had from a long time ago because of that exposure to folks who are too young to know you can't do that.
Yeah. I'll add one other thing to that, which is kind of related to what you're saying. I think that noticing, over a 20-year career arc for me, and then lots of people we hire now, the thing that everyone forgets being at Stanford is you're surrounded by that amazing creative intelligence here at Stanford. You go off into the, quote, real world, and there's a high variance in terms of the caliber and quality of the teams that you work with.
Yeah.
And working with really smart, creative people is going to have a huge delta on the overall trajectory of what you contribute in the world, in my experience. And so picking, you know, where you have the capability to do that, always effectively picking the teammates that are pushing you forward and smarter than you and creative and pushing you forward is going to be, I think, one of the determining factors on how much you'll contribute throughout your career. And people don't always take this into account.
Mike, you raised something tangentially I wanted to ask about that kind of came up in the last panel as well. Peter Thiel, who's a student here, has been associated with this notion of you can go right to it. You can become an entrepreneur, and maybe you don't need 4 years or 8 years of schooling. And on the other side of the coin is Neil Gershenfeld, who's a physicist at MIT, who styles himself as the anti-Peter Thiel, who believes and has a number of students in key positions in Silicon Valley that, you know, there's a value to learning physics, to learning computer science. Could you guys come down on one side or the other? Or what's the value? What's the value? Can you go right to it, or do you need...
Are you asking me?
Yeah, first.
My answer is going to be nuanced and probably thus unsatisfactory. It won't be as inflammatory as just agreeing with one or the other. But I think there's room for both. In any of these examples where you see someone who drops out of school and starts a company, the successful ones surround themselves with other people who have the experience that they do not have. Mm-hmm. And I can't think of actually a case study that is counter to that. And so to say that you need to be fresh out of school or you need to be experienced, it's kind of not an either or. You need a company and an organization that has the right balance of, you know, Vince said it really well. It's the, I don't know enough, so I didn't know this wasn't possible, so I tried it anyway, and it turns out now it is. And you need some of that, and you also need people who can help, you know, direct and guide via the experience that they brought. So I think we need both, and I think it really boils down to the individual and the thing you're creating. You know, there are industries where you need deep knowledge to understand what's really going on, and, you know, especially in biology or in a highly regulated industries where that experience is required for you to start up. And there's other things where it's like you've got a great idea and you and your friends use it because it's on Android and iOS and I can see the use case for it. I can build it today. I don't need to go to school for another 4 years to push that forward. And so there are many startups like that. So I think it really depends on the company you're creating, and then either way you do it, you need both. You need the naivete and you need the experience.
So, you know, Walter Isaacson's recent book, The Innovators, one of the things that he focuses on in that book thematically is collaboration. And his point is a lot of things don't happen unless multiple parties are involved and are engaged and, you know, are in conflict with each other and, you know, igniting, you know, sticks rubbing together. I mean, I can tell you that when Bob Kahn and I were doing our work, that we used to have these incredible, you know, knockdown, drag-out arguments. And until we figured out that the reason we were arguing is that he had a different model in his head than I did about what we were arguing about. And so then when we got into one of these heated discussions, we would stop and say, wait a minute, what's the model that you're using here? And we would get that sorted out. Then we'd have another debate. But this idea of surrounding yourself with people with different experiences and capabilities is absolutely essential to success. I have to say, just to reinforce one other thing, when I was here as a professor, I knew that any student that walked in my door at Stanford was going to be smart as hell. And so it made things so much easier. You know, if you found somebody who was interested in what you wanted to do, you knew they had capability to help. And I sure had a great team doing the early internet work.
So this sort of speaks to something that David and Vint were saying. The four of you have sort of, your careers have been defined by Moore's Law, as all of us in the Valley. 10 days ago, or maybe 8 days ago, I sat in at a day-long symposium had by the Stanford X had on the state of computing systems and semiconductors. And, you know, is Moore's Law dead yet? That was a question, and there's never really a clear answer, but it looked like it was. And then I had this really interesting moment at dinner when I sat next to a computer architect from Harvard, David Brooks, and he was almost giddy because he could see Moore's Law was ending, and the way he looked at it, this is going to be great for architects. We've gotten this free ride for the last 50 years. Now we're going to have to work, and it's this opportunity to innovate. So could you look at the Moore's Law prism from that direction? David?
Yeah, you know, I hadn't heard somebody articulate it that way, but I think that's exactly right. You know, first of all, the question is Moore's Law dead? And of course, it's been predicted many times, and there's the issue of the boy who cried wolf, but this time it actually does look to me like it's in pretty serious trouble, with at least a gap between that and new technologies. But it is interesting in architecture when, if we just have some period of time to think architecturally without things becoming so different in terms of the hardware that the design rules change. Maybe we will come up with some interesting novel architectures. It was this period where when Intel had chips out there that were faster than any special purpose machine, there was this kind of architectural winter because that was just the best way to do almost anything. And maybe now if it settles down somewhere, there will be a chance for that sort of innovation. I don't know.
Well, did anybody on the panel know much about the True North, the neural types of chips that IBM is producing, which is one very interesting brand? And we heard a little bit earlier about image processing using ideas like that. And the other one is this memristor idea where computation and memory are all in the same place, mm-hmm. and you remember where you were when you turned the power off because it's magnetic. This stuff feels like, not to mention graphene, which everybody gets excited about. So it feels like there is a situation right now where there are sort of latent, interesting opportunities that are far away from the existing architectures.
I have never seen a bigger mismatch between the computation we're trying to do and the underlying computer architecture there. If you look at, the revolution that's happening right now in AI via, deep neural nets, just convolutional neural nets, most of, everyone who's doing this at big scale, we're using it on GPUs that were intended to render graphics. Uh-huh. We're using it because it's the best place to get lots of floating point performance next to a relatively high performance memory. But it's so mismatched to the actual computing load that relatively minor changes to that architecture are going to result in dramatic improvements in throughput there, and we're seeing that. But if you took, whole hog differential approaches and said, I need a lot of computation close to a whole lot of data, as opposed to the other way around now, that you would get, I think, pretty dramatic improvement. So I'm really optimistic about that we've now had a tipping point in a useful enough software to really drive some new changes in computer architecture.
And are you facing at Facebook kind of computing loads where you're going to have to look away from commodity? I mean, can you continue to write on commodity products, or will you have to do new things?
I mean, we are. I mean, we've already done this in a variety, but we actually build all of the hardware that's in our data centers now and the data centers themselves. So everything in that building is designed by us for our own purposes.
Down to the silicon?
What's that?
Down to the silicon?
We're still buying, parts from everyone else, but the assembly of it together is ours. And, we've experimented with different designs for that as well. I think, for the main Facebook use load, caseload, I think you're going to see us continue to use commodity compute because it works really well for that. When you talk about things like, again, deep learning and a lot of these things, that is where the workload is really mismatched to the hardware, and I think more experimentation at the hardware layer is really interesting. And then, of course, there's a whole separate tangent on this, which is, we're also investing in virtual reality. And when you look at the graphic, people get really excited about the amazing advances in GPUs on desktops, but when you look at trying to drive, an 8K by 8K per eye resolution, VR device at 120 hertz, it like the HDMI cable doesn't have enough bandwidth, DisplayPort can't do it at high enough bandwidth. So everything breaks, like not just the compute in it, but just getting the pixels from the computer to the headset requires some changing in interfaces. So I think there's a lot of interesting things that'll happen in that entire system if I'm trying to build a system that's fundamentally trying to jack into the perceptual systems of a human and really, help us, which is the ultimate, aim of this stuff, is really give us systems that make us feel like we're present somewhere else. And that requires enough fidelity to really tap into the human perceptual system, which I don't think our current computing systems are well set up to do.
You're not worried that virtual reality will only produce virtual profit, are you?
I do think there's too many bottlenecks in the computer architectures of today, so I think the comments that we're going to have a big change is right, because I just see too many limitations in the sort of traditional von Neumann architectures. It'll also, going back to the education theme, it'll give us a chance for everybody to retrain themselves, because the programming models will change, the abstractions will change. I don't think people know how to program multi-core x86 architectures yet. This will definitely stretch people's abilities.
Yeah. David, are you still justifying going down that special purpose, high performance path? I mean, has the world caught up with you yet?
I'm agnostic about that, or a better way of saying it is I just don't know. For our application, we have to implement our own chips. That has to be ASICs, or, we're 200 times faster than you can get with the standard architecture, so we have to. The real question is, can you do that with a lot of other applications? And there's some where provably the answer is no. You can literally prove that the bandwidth that you need is so big that it doesn't matter what you do on the silicon. Are there other problems where you could imagine that would help? But is there a general rule? I just don't know, really.
Can I just mention one other? There's a guy named Ivan Sutherland, and some of you know him, I'm sure. Ivan is very interested in asynchronous circuits. You know, get rid of the damn clock, because, you know, with the density of the chipsets that we have now, you have to have multiple clocks, blah, blah, blah. And he's basically saying, get rid of the damn things and just run an asynchronous design. And I think that's kind of an exciting alternative to what we're conventionally used to, which is this clock going wang, 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 and forcing us to do things only in clock sync. So I don't know if anybody, I don't know if you guys have done anything in that space. And of course, I'm just a software guy, so I don't know what the hell I'm talking about.
I wanted to ask the same question kind of in a policy way. You know, historically, physicists after World War II and building the bomb called the shots on computing. I mean, it really shaped the design of computing for many, many years. Mm-hmm. And it occurs to me that last year, both the United States and Europe embarked on these billion-dollar scale problems that relating to the brain. Europe's was more controversial than ours, but both of them involve new computing models, to Vint's point. And which I thought was great, very exciting stuff. But then I've been talking to the climatologists, and it turns out that the climatologists and computer scientists believe that for about $200 million, you could build a machine, a special purpose machine, that did climate simulation at fine grain that would actually give us a better explanation of whether or not global warming was an existential threat. And I thought, holy shit, you know, if you can do that for $200 million, I mean, so, did we give the administration and the Europeans bad advice? And what kind of role should computer scientists be playing now that we're at the table and the way physicists were after World War II?
You know, these kinds of computations are only as good as the model that they were built around. And so I kind of worry about arguments. It sounds like you want to build a climate orrery or something like that. I worry that the design is very dependent on knowledge that we may or may not have about all the dynamics of, you know, climate. And I'm pretty convinced that we have a problem. You know, just watching the ice flows and the things melting and rivers going up and this and that and the other. But I'm not as convinced that spending $200 million to build a special purpose machine will necessarily produce a helpful answer, unless our depth of understanding of the models is adequate. And that might mean more measurement in order to match models to measured results. I don't know. How do you guys feel about that?
No, I don't really know. There is a correct answer to that, I'm sure. And it's a great question, a very important question. I personally don't know enough about the application. You know, what you've got is an initial value problem, at least many of these things, and those can become unstable in a relatively short period of time sometimes, and it becomes chaotic and you wind up with something that's not meaningful. There are other, you know, areas where it really does work and you need a lot of computer power. So I don't know about that particular case. It's worth being cautious, though. I'm not saying, you know, not spending $200 million if it makes sense. I'm not an expert. But to make sure that there aren't mathematical or other kinds of constraints that make the raw computer power, you know, unnecessary or irrelevant. I just don't know.
I mean, given the scale at which the government manages to spend money, spending $200 million as an investigative tool doesn't seem like a bad idea, although you'd have to try to match it to experiments, so to speak.
So Maren Samani talked about the fact that the department is now 28% women, and actually that seemed like still a pretty small number to me, even though I guess progress has been made. But then I wonder, the Times had an op-ed piece yesterday by a Berkeley professor, I think she's an engineer,
yeah,
who said that the numbers changed dramatically when you had programs or courses that focused on socially relevant topics, and all of a sudden the number of women shot up to actually more than 50%, and she said that's actually the solution. And I was trying to think if there are ways that you could pull computer science in that way. I mean, Terry Winograd, of course, has Liberation Technologies. I don't know what the percentage is, but does that seem like a workable way to change the mix of the field?
It's actually, isn't that kind of what's happened to the curriculum when we saw this wonderful extension of the connection between computer science and a whole lot of other disciplines as now part of the Stanford curriculum, which in effect should be drawing people in to the computer science aspects of things they care about. So I mean, it feels to me like that's a natural direction to head in, and that Stanford's already on its way in that direction. I mean, did I misunderstand that?
Other thoughts?
I mean, this is one of my hopes that this is, you know, it's not yet fulfilled, but computing is applying to every facet of real life. You know, name an industry, health, transportation, you talked about climate, you know, obviously just basic connection and communication between people. And so you would hope that you would do a better job of attracting the full range of people who have particular interests in those domains. So they want to actually solve a problem in there, and one of the best ways to solve it is via computing. And so I think that the more that we can have computing be a very broad thing rather than the thing you just do in a basement, you know, or the thing you do to make a video game, you know, which is going to appeal to a very small percentage of the world's population, the more we can make it apply to everything in the world and let people know that that may be the highest leverage way they can impact the world, then my hope would be we can get more people into it and get them interested. We've certainly seen a lot of interest that, you know, Facebook is a very universal product. It's used by, you know, 1.44 billion people. And so that's, you know, one of our big recruiting appeals. It's just a lot of people, you know, our basic pitch is pretty simple. It's like, come work on something that, you know, a quarter of the world uses. And that's a message that appeals to a pretty broad swath of the world's population. And so I hope that that's more the norm in the future and less the outlier case.
I did learn something about tactics at the U.S. Military Academy, and it didn't have nothing to do with military tactics. It had to do with classroom tactics. I visited there just a few weeks ago, and the people who were running the computer science department said to me that one of the things they carefully do is to make sure that any class in computer science has at least three women in it. They may have more, but they never want to have less than three. And the reason for this is the social dynamics change dramatically when you have a few other people there who will defend you from the idiot boys who, you know, don't have any social sense at all. It's harder to defend yourself because it looks very, you know, defensive. On the other hand, or self-serving. On the other hand, if somebody else, you know, jumps to your rescue, it makes a big difference. And so this very interesting little statistic, get at least three women in the class or more, makes a big difference for the way those classes turn out. And the longevity of the women staying in the program.
It may be the long view, but I think one thing is to try to get learning about basic computer science concepts and programming into second and third grade education. Very, very young. It's clear that it's possible for people to start learning that now, and frankly, it seems a lot more important than cursive handwriting is at this stage of life. So, and I think one of the things that happens, I have a daughter who is not in technology and who was interested early on. I think I've seen too many cases like that where they lose interest at certain points. I think if it was ingrained more in their upbringing and was something, as Mike was saying, that they used to solve problems in their lives, it would be something that would stick with them. I think the universities clearly need to do things too, and I think, you know, Stanford had some great programs like C++ and other things going on here. But, you know, I think it's got to start much earlier in the pipeline, but it's a long view. It's not going to solve the problem 3 years from now or 5 years from now.
So you've all also lived through a couple of what have become called AI winters. And it used to be that Ray Kurzweil was the only guy who would say that thinking machines were right around the corner. But recently, it's become much more fashionable. Stephen Hawking, Elon Musk, Bill Gates have all sort of weighed in on the imminence of perhaps malevolent intelligence created by us but autonomous from us. Are those guys overstating the how close the headlights are?
Yes.
Weren't we talking about buggy software earlier? What are you going to do with a buggy AI? That's one of my questions.
go ahead.
I was going to say, try to get Siri to book you dinner reservations and tell me how worried you are about the oncoming AI apocalypse.
Let me rephrase the question. Is it just Should the discussion be about autonomy instead of intelligence? Should we reframe the question?
I mean. So here's a more serious. Sorry, I jumped right in. Did you want to answer? Sorry, this is a topic near and dear to my heart. So look, I think that there's a couple of different ways to look at this, and this is the serious part of this. Is I think we are linearly extrapolating progress too much from current things. We have current systems that are doing really amazing things in specific domains. So, you know, image recognition to understand inside this image what objects are there and where are they. We're making, you know, unbelievable dramatic progress, mostly through the application of, you know, a 20 or 30 year old technique, convolutional neural nets, with some tweaks on top of it and a whole lot of data and compute. I can take that same technique and apply it to a bunch of very simple problems that it will fail disastrously in, and it is clear it does not have the basic fundamentals needed to solve those problems. I'm talking about like answering some basic yes-no questions, or you know, two phrases, and then asking, you know, what's a fact based on those two phrases. So it's clear that in order to achieve systems that are much more intelligent than they are today, we require not just turning the crank on what we're doing now, but actually some real fundamental breakthroughs. And this is part of the fun of this, is like there's a lot of really smart people who are trying to find new techniques and new ways to solve programs that do this. But we can't even write programs that can reliably generate regular expressions, which is a very basic form of computation. Nevertheless, write programs, which would be what you'd really need to do in order to build systems that could evolve in an interesting way and truly learn beyond just a narrow band of programming. So I think there is a lot left to be done, and it's easy to accidentally just kind of draw a straight line from where we are to solving really hard problems. Having said that, I think going back to the first conversation, it's just, look, I think we need to worry about things whenever there is an application. Talking about general safety is a hard thing to do. Talking about safety of something in a specific domain, you know, the way we approach, just use the analogy again, you know, the systems and techniques we use for aircraft safety is very different than those for automobile safety. Those are both transportation safety, related things, very different technologies employed in them, techniques, and very different things you solve by working the problem. You understand what are the risks, what's the highest, you know, probability thing that can go wrong, and what are the most leveraged ways in order to solve that. And so I think we need to break these problems down instead of worrying about a big overreaching problem, is just understand where are all the places in the world where we may have challenges or safety, and then go attack those specifically. But my own personal view.
So you mentioned autonomy. I think that the really key issue here is how much do we allow the software to decide for us to take actions on our behalf, and how much do we insist on being in the loop? I think that the extreme scary language, I think, is overblown. I think most of what we're relying on is assistance as opposed to purely autonomy. And I am excited about that. The things that you can get computers to do today feel almost like magic because of the amount of power that they bring to bear. I mean, whenever I do a search, I'm astonished that, you know, 0.018 seconds produces this incredible response thing, and I get the answer I'm looking for at the top of the list. I remember being amazed once. I typed in, I couldn't remember the name of the song. I knew it had something about, oh, Miss Something, you know, Unfortunate Miss Something. And so I just typed that, literally, oh, Miss Something, Unfortunate Miss Something, and the system found exactly the right answer with the name of the song and the whole thing. And I remember thinking, well, that was pretty cool. So the idea here is that we will have a lot more assistance than we have had in the past, but I am not so sure that we will be faced with machines that are running completely and totally autonomously. I do admit that driving around in a car, being driven around in a car that's driving on its own is slightly weird. I've been waiting for the one where you take off down the street and the policeman pulls you off the side of the road and wants to give you a ticket, and you say, but officer, nobody was driving, we were all in the back seat. So I think there is liability here, you know, kind of hovering somewhere in the background on appliances and devices that are making relatively autonomous decisions, and that will probably be the cut point. Where do we decide that we can be safely out of the loop, and where do we insist on staying in the loop?
Yeah. So the logical follow-on to that question, I was kind of surprised in the last panel there was seemed to be a consensus about no jobs fairly soon. Do you guys have strong views one way or another about the consequences of this current wave of automation? Mm-hmm.
Oh, this reminds me of the Industrial Revolution and the Luddites who were destroying all of the looms and machines and everything else. look, let's face it. We build, you know, all these automated devices, and we know there's going to be bugs in the software, so the software guys still have jobs. The machines will break down, and they have to get fixed, and they're probably not going to fix themselves for a long time to come. We can create more work per second with these kinds of systems than we ever have before, so I'm not worried about that. Now, the jobs may be different, though, and that is important. So retraining is a big deal, and that's why MOOCs and things like that may turn out to be so important.
David, do you have a...
Yeah, I mean, it's on actually the three last things, but in terms of jobs, I think during this whole recession, this long period of recession, it got a little scary to the end for me. It was sort of like what's always happened is there was a dislocation, and then the jobs came back, and they required new skill sets and so forth. It went on a little bit too long for my comfort, and I started worrying about, boy, you know, you do see these productivity numbers going very high, and wage inequality and wealth inequality skyrocketing and so forth. So I was a little worried. I do think in the long run, what will happen is we'll adjust to that. And I sort of, when I get depressed, I think about this very, I think, optimistic model, which is a desert island scenario. Do you really want to, you know, you've got 15 people, you've got to survive on the island. Are you really going to have some of them unemployed because some of them are better? No, everybody's got to kick in somehow. And I have a feeling we'll find ourselves moving toward that sort of equilibrium. If I could just say one other thing about the previous part, kind of related, which is I'm not so worried. I can't get myself too worked up about the AI autonomy thing just because it's hard for me to imagine at this stage. It seems like it's well off into the future. At the very least, our kids will be worrying about it. I'm worried about the whole question of, you know, viscerally worried about correct systems, just systems that do what we want them to do when we program them.
Yeah.
Some of it is, you know, I was on PCAST and we dealt with a lot of NSA's kinds of issues, cybersecurity on the defensive side, just the defensive side. And, you know, talking to people about what was going on, I expected there to be a lot of formal verification that had finally gotten somewhere with a survivable core. And I was told, no, we really don't think so. We don't know how to protect any of that stuff really securely. And then I heard from somebody else on PCAST about just how much of driving in an automobile now, not just driverless cars, but right now, are controlled by computers. I knew there were some, but, and at that point, you know, it was like connecting the NSA part to that. And we've all written computer programs, and you know when you get it to the point where you know it's correct. I mean, it's just obviously correct, right?
Right.
You know? How much of the time is it? And I don't want to think about that.
We just have a couple minutes left. Let's open it up to the audience. If there are microphones and if people have questions for the panelists, now's the time. This one, and then you. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question for Vint Cerf. I wonder if you can just give us a 60-second overview of the invention of the internet.
Okay. I think I could actually do that if you want me to try. Bob Kahn figured out that if we were going to use computers in command and control, we were going to have to use other than telephone lines to connect everything together because the machines had to be in mobile, ground vehicles and in aircraft and ships at sea. So he figured out that we needed to have, radio and satellite communications in addition to the wireline ARPANET, which is so successful. So he came to visit in 73 here at Stanford and said, here's our problem, what should we do? And we very quickly, we had some ground rules. We couldn't change any of the networks to make them know they were part of the internet because it was just too hard. So we said, okay, so we've got these networks and they are all packet switched and they all have different speeds and everything else. So we'll have to have boxes between them that know how to talk to each of the networks so they can push packets back and forth in those networks, but we'll have to enclose internet things in the packets that are flowing through the other networks. So that we called a gateway because we didn't know we were supposed to call it a router. And and so we had this model that the internet knowledge would be the edge devices, the hosts and the client machines, and in the gateways, but there wouldn't be any knowledge of internet in any of the intervening networks. We made sure that there was no mention of routing or anything in the internet protocol. because we didn't want it to know about how that worked, because we wanted to try different routing algorithms. We made sure that the internet protocol didn't know anything about the underlying transport, so if a new transport came along, we could sweep in underneath. And we made sure that the internet packets had no clue what they were carrying. It was just a bag of bits. So if you wanted to invent a new application, it was interpreting bits at the edges of the net, not in the core of the net. So if you had a new application, you didn't have to change the internet. Now, that's roughly speaking how that worked. And of course, lots of stuff happened after that, like, you know, the domain name system and Tim Berners-Lee and the World Wide Web. But the fact is, this infrastructure was so general and was intended to, it didn't do anything in particular that made it so powerful.
Thank you. That's interesting.
PhD 81. You asked the question about the various faces of computer science. Is it mathematics? Is it engineering? I wanted to comment that I think through most of my career it's been mostly mathematics and engineering. More people employed in engineering, but the mathematics, the algorithms, computability theory, fundamentally, you know, at the base of almost everything, with far more employment in engineering. But what I think may be interesting is that in the 1980s, with machine learning becoming much larger in interest and possible, and then with the World Wide Web and the internet providing vast amounts of data, the field became far more empirical in nature. Mm-hmm. And now if you survey PhD students, how many are in what part of the field, so many of them are in machine learning and doing things which are fundamentally, I think, a mixture of empiricism and algorithms with systems supporting it. So I think what makes the field really exciting is that it's a beautiful synthesis of mathematics, engineering, encapsulation, abstraction, reuse, with almost zero marginal cost abstractions, which is a really wonderful part of this since they're software. And finally now empiricism, even more so as we apply the field to every discipline, like say biochemistry, when then there's a blurring and it really becomes very scientific in nature. I don't know if you guys agree with that thought, that the field has changed, become that tripod base.
So I've always enjoyed trying to compare mathematicians and physicists, okay? So I consider myself kind of more on the mathematical side. And you know, we like everything to come out, and the equations all balance, and you get an answer back. The physicists, on the other hand, have to deal with the real world, and nothing ever comes out quite the way you expect it to. What's happened, I think, Alfred, is that we have entered into a period where there is so much information, so much data, that we're forced into this very empirical view, which is more like what a physicist has to deal with, the real world, as opposed to having everything come out just right as we do in the mathematical world. So it's more interesting now to be in computer science because it's turned into this real world phenomenon where you have to struggle with reality as opposed to fantasy.
I think Alfred.
One final question.
Yes, so with the explosion of objects that are going to be now connected on one hand and the explosion of data traffic that is happening in the internet, do you believe that we need to reinvent again the internet to cope with this new situation? And the question is for all of you.
Wow.
You should answer that one.
Yeah, I think so.
So I'm sorry, but I didn't get all of the question exactly right. So would you help me with that?
Basically, with the explosion of devices and data on the internet, do we need to rethink the fundamental plumbing of how things work?
You know, the answer is yes. And I am very concerned about scale. I'm very concerned about safety and security, and particularly so with this Internet of Things, because people don't normally remember when PCs used to be things that were not connected to anything because they were your personal machine, and then they get connected to the internet and suddenly they're vulnerable because we didn't think about that part. The same kind of phenomenon is likely to happen with, you know, your refrigerator and other appliances. I'm scared of a headline that says 100,000 refrigerators attack Bank of America. and it's not because the program that drove the refrigerators was bad. It's because somebody managed to download or upload or whatever, you know, Linux onto the processor that is running the refrigerator, because you can't get a dumb chip anymore. And so then they put in all kinds of malware and the refrigerators take off. So we have a huge amount to learn. And I hope we learn it quickly enough to avoid serious problems. But it's a very real concern. And it's one that every computer scientist should be worried about.
One quick last question from this gentleman.
Covered by the previous one, thank you. I was covered by the previous one.
Oh, okay. then let's give the panelists a round of applause. Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.